We have a question, and I think it's a good one because I'm guessing it goes to the heart of what many of you are thinking and wondering in those, the message we can take back to our communities. And I'll throw it out. I think all three of you certainly feel free to answer. How would you encourage second, third, and fourth generation hyphenated Americans to learn about their cultural roots, particularly those without resources to travel? Meb, you want to start with that?
Well, first it starts at home. You know, you gotta know who you are. And Mebrahatom Kaflesgi stands out. So I'm gonna get asked where you're from always. And you know, at home I have three daughters, and I try to teach them about Eritrea or where their mom and dad were born. But obviously, since they're born here, you also want to assimilate them to this, and you have to be able to educate them a little bit. Just say, hey, you are who you are, and don't forget your roots. If you can do that, if you can abroad, you know, you can go to services. I mean, I'm involved with the Eritrean church in San Diego. Whenever I train at Altitude Mammoth Lakes, but whenever in San Diego, I'm involved with that. And in fact, they used to have gathering. And in fact, they gave me a pair of shoes for the first time, a kind of word of hope that we talked about, or encouragement. And it says, wow, if these people believe in me, then I have to work extra harder. And so you have to start with the community that are local without traveling. But eventually, hopefully, if you work hard and you set your budget or your goal, it's always good to take people back to where their roots are and educate them. And you know what? This opportunity that you have here is priceless. And not everybody has it, so work harder and acknowledge that you can be successful, but it's also good to take a step back to say, you know what? I'm lucky to have this opportunity, and I want to maximize my potential and your passion. If you could do that, then, you know, you'll be good.
This event really celebrates America's diversity, and I guess there's not a real clear answer to that question, but I guess by posing that question, it's already says that you're curious about your heritage. Diaspora communities, it's really a quintessential American resource because it provides an interest point. You could be first generation, second generation, third generation, fifth, sixth, whatever, but to build that understanding of your roots and where your parents or your grandparents or great-great-grandparents came from is your own story. And I think one suggestion would be to get to know your story, ask questions. You have such access to the internet and friends or overseas, and I would encourage you to know your story because it's something that you'll take with you for the rest of your life.
I would just, you know, I would definitely piggyback on that, and you know, in terms of saying, you know, stay connected, and you know, even though, you know, life evolves, it really starts at the home base, and educating your children. So when, you know, they get to a mature age, you know, they do know that story. They do have that written on their hearts. So when, you know, they get to the age where they have kids, they'll be able to share the similar stories, you know, of you as a parent, what you went through, you know, in your homeland, or, you know, what your grandparents went through in your homeland. And even if those little bits, you know, of stories where they don't actually know the location, know the landscape or what it looked like, you know, that's where the internet comes in. That's where, you know, other resources can come in where you can read and educate yourself on those, you know, different landscapes, on the different countries, the different cities, as well as, you know, painting that picture in your mind, and you can learn more about your culture.
Something that I've wondered about as covering international sports for quite a long time, and is the message that goes out about the United States when they see you with your heritage, all three of you, but especially Meb and Michelle, representing the United States with the flag going up at a World Championships, an Olympics, whatever. You are an American, and Michelle, I know you, as I said, best of all, and there's no one who's more proud of this country than Michelle Kwan, except maybe the two gentlemen who are on either side of you. But I'm curious, all three of you, just as someone who's watched this scene, we've all watched this scene, right, play out, the medal ceremony, and we're so proud of people from whatever country we're from. So as a U.S. citizen myself, I'm very proud for you. And James, I want to include you in this too, but even if the flag's not raising when you're getting your Super Bowl championship. But curious what message you think you send the world when people from around the world look at America and see me, and of course, even more important, see you. And I hope that makes some sense, that question. Mm-hmm. Take it and run with it. Thank you.
Well, the United States gave us an opportunity that is priceless for all of us. I'm one of 11 brothers and sisters. I might be notable because of my athletic accomplishment, but I have brothers that have gone to become engineering, doctors, lawyers, Stanford graduate, and whatnot. Everybody has gone to do something great because of the opportunity that the United States provides. For me, personally, to represent the United States is a dream come true. In 1998, when I finished with my competitive at UCLA, I decided, you know, I lived 10 years in Eritrea, 10 years in the United States, a year and a half in Italy. It was in a big decision, one of the biggest decisions I ever made. But, you know, some of my brothers said, go for Eritrea. Some of my other siblings said, go for the United States. But I really thought about it and sat down. Most of my memories come from the United States. Since 12 years old, I've been here. And it was one of the difficult decisions that I made, but it's the best decision because the United States done so much things for me and for my siblings. And the least thing I could do is represent our country. And it gives me a great honor and privilege to live in the United States, but also put our flag on the podium because, you know, it's all about hard work. Nothing is handed to you, but you visualize those things, that a flashback when you came as a kid and going to junior high and didn't speak the language and culture. But the United States is about the melting pot from different ethnicity, different religion, different everything that, hey, it is what it is. And it gave me a great honor for me to have this opportunity to showcase when you wear that USA jersey, you wear it with pride. And when you feel like giving up, you don't want to give up because you are representing the United States, but also you know that your roots are also representing you, whether it's from Eritrea or people from Italy cheering for me. Why? Because you want to be the best human being that you can, and hopefully, and when the flag goes up, you feel very proud that you have accomplished your goal to the country that adopted you and gave you opportunity. And you know that little hope, that seed there, gave us a chance to be the best we can, and you could only do that in the United States. Yeah, parents would have been satisfied in Italy and others, but they wanted a better opportunity for their kids. Just anybody would, and we have to take that hard and maximize that potential, and hopefully we have delivered, as you know, and many others will deliver behind us, whether it's first generation, second generation, or others, because the United States has come from all diverse of ethnicity, and I hope I have done proud to represent our country to the best that I can, not only during the Olympics or New York City Marathon, but every day of my life.
Meb mentioned wearing the team uniform, wearing USA. It gives me chills just thinking of it when I was a child and dreaming of one day owning the world team USA outfit or the Olympic gear, and walking with your teammates. The thing that I picture of the Olympics and walking behind the American flag with my fellow teammates, so proud to represent the United States, to skate and try to do your best. And sort of when people say, oh, you have the weight of the country on your shoulders, you do, because you feel like you need to represent the best you can, and you hope that you make your family and your all Americans proud. And one of the things that when I was skating, it was one of those things that not only was it a very humbling experience, but it was such a proud moment for my family to know that they gave those opportunities to their children, and now to step out of the world stage in front of millions of people and to represent the country. And I could just sense that my parents were so proud as well.
I can actually put a little spin on it and look at it from a different standpoint. And in the Super Bowl, you know, it's, you know, televised across the world. And even though I was born here in the United States, you know, my last name is Nigerian. So, you know, you look at it and say, wow, okay, you know, is he American, is he not? But, you know, the aspect of other Nigerians watching, you know, cheering me on, saying, wow, that's our brother. You know, he's about to play in one of the biggest, you know, games. And that type of, you know, boldness and, you know, proudness that comes from that, as well as, you know, cheering fans that are Americans, you know, cheering. And, you know, I can sit there and say, wow, okay, this is what, you know, the American dream looks like. But as well as to the fan that's sitting in the stands, that's what the American dream looks like as well. You know, and it's really what you make it with the opportunity that you're given. And, you know, being able to, you know, stand on that big platform, it's such an honor in itself. So.
All three of you, of course, are role models to millions. But we have a question here, turning the tables just a little bit. Each of you have taken your passion for sports, this question asks, and turned it into much bigger initiatives. It is inspiring. So the question is, what everyday heroes inspire you and your work? And I'll kind of amend that, everyday heroes, but I guess we'd also probably like to hear who were your role models growing up in your sport or in life, as well as, of course, the question, the everyday heroes who inspire you and your work.
Well, like Michelle mentioned earlier about her dad's education, my mom never went to school. My dad only had seventh grade education, but they managed to understand that higher education is a way of life, the education keeps alive. And for me, my parents are my role models as everyday life and great example. And in terms of running, Haile Gebrselassie from Ethiopia is a guy I always looked up to and wanted to be like him, and got a chance to compete against him, and you know, at the U.S. level. And Jim Ryan is another, you know, first high school guy to break 4 minute. And he grew up in Kansas, and all he said is, whether it's hot, snow, or windy, you got to go out every day and do it. And I take that at heart, to be able to say, you know what, when you don't feel like it, or it's snowing in Mammoth Lakes, somebody else is training harder than you, so you better get out the door. You know, sometimes the first step, getting out the door, is the most difficult. But once you set your goals in writing, you have committed yourself, and you can go accomplish those goals.
My parents were also my role models growing up, just to think that they sacrificed so much. When people ask me, you know, how much did you sacrifice for the sport of figure skating? And I had to think about it. I'm like, I didn't make any sacrifices. There were choices that I made in my life and when I was a kid. I chose not to go out and hang out with my friends, go to the movies, because I knew that the next day I would be sleepy. But for my parents, it was always, they sacrificed so much to give us the opportunity to drive us to the rink at 4:30, 3:30 in the morning. And I hope to be that kind of my mother that my parents were to me. And I also have role models throughout my skating career and mentors, and at the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. I think one of my role models growing up was, I would have to say, Brian Boitano, because in 1988 I watched Brian Boitano win the Olympics in Calgary. And I remember sitting in front of the TV thinking, okay, now I want to go to the Olympics. I was so inspired that I thought the next day I could just sign up and go. It was easy as that. But throughout the years, I've gotten a chance to know Brian Boitano by tours and skating competitions, and he become a really good friend of mine. So I had the rare chance, rare opportunity to not only have a role model that is a positive role model, who I looked up to, and then had a chance to become friends with him and follow him around on the ice and ask him questions and serve as a mentor for me.
Well, I'll share a quick little story. When I was young, I was, you know, 6 years old, and you know, being from Nigeria, I played soccer. That's, you know, me and my brothers, we played soccer. And I remember going to my dad one day and saying, well, you know, I want to play, you know, football. And he's like, oh, you already do. And I'm like, and I was like, no, I want to play American football. And he was like, no, you can't play. And, you know, of course, you know, being the little kid that I was, I, you know, kind of snuck in and played anyway. And you know, my coach went back to my dad and was like, you know, you have to see your son. Like, he's really good. You have to come to a game. And so, you know, being reluctant to do so, he came to a game and saw me play and was so amazed and was like, wow. And for that gratification, seeing my dad, you know, so excited about my performance, you know, kind of pushed me even more. But the role model really stemmed from me as a young age watching, you know, players like, you know, Emmett Smith, you know, run for a touchdown and saying, wow, you know, I want to do that. I can do that one day. You know, I can be that person, and kind of being able to say, okay, well, then how do I get there? And setting up goals to do that, you know, as well as, you know, my mother who's here, Dr. Rosie Hedibo, you know, who's in the house, you know. And, you know, from a young age, you know, six, you know, till now, she's been to every one of my games, drove me, been there, hasn't missed one. And, you know, that type of commitment to me is, you know, is amazing. So.
And it was, what, Mother's Day just 2 days ago. Yeah. So happy Mother's Day. Happy. To all the moms out there. Here's a question from Naomi. Naomi, am I pronouncing it right? Hey, Lou? Hi there, Naomi. I'm sorry. I hope I'm close. It's a very good question, and I think it's an important one for our society, for our world, about women in sports. I'm a woman from the Ethiopian diaspora and lifelong soccer player. Being an athlete has significantly contributed to my confidence and sense of determination and fair play. How can we work to promote sports for women in our diasporas and countries of origin? So the issue of encouraging the play for women, as we know, just this year, last year, the London Olympics 2012, for the first time ever, every country had at least one female athlete in its delegation. First time ever. And in many ways, we were calling it the Women's Olympics because of that. The U.S. team had more women than men for the first time ever. It was being called Team Title IX. U.S. women won over 60% of the gold medals for the United States. So we see the benefits, obviously, in the United States of Title IX, the law that was signed by Richard Nixon in June of 1972 that's changed the playing fields of America. Obviously, other countries don't have Title IX. Other countries have, there are issues. There are still issues in our country. So the question is an excellent one. What can we do specifically to help girls and women get more opportunity in sports? Michelle, go ahead.
Well, in 2011, Secretary Clinton launched the Empowering Women and Girls Through Sports. And a component of the initiative is mentoring. And it's about 20 women from different parts of the world coming to the United States, being mentored in different areas of business, of technology, of STEM, of sports, and being able to empower them so the things that they learn in the United States in business or in other areas, they can take back to their country. But the value of sports is enormous. I've traveled, like I said, to a number of countries as a public diplomacy envoy, and realize that it's a way to connect, but also to empower. So empowering women and girls in certain countries, like Christine mentioned, some countries don't have Title IX, where it's equal opportunity, where it's an equal level playing field. And sports is a way that empowers youth and young women to say, you know what? I can attain this. I can do this. Setting goals, because the lessons that you learn in sports is invaluable. You say, I'm going to set this goal. Meb said, you said that you jot it down when you put it in writing and say, you know, my goal is to accomplish this. It might be small goals, it might be large goals, but that gives you a sense of accomplishment. So the things that you learn in sports, you can apply it outside of the playing field as well.
Well, for the Ethiopians, you guys have great role models, including Daratu Tulu, 96 Olympic champion. But my goal with the Med Foundation, maintain excellent balance through health, education, fitness, is to give back to youth, inspire them to be able to set goals, you know, and education is a key to life. You know, with the budget cut, a lot of physical education class are cut in the United States, but hopefully you can do that in the same thing in Ethiopia. They have camps there and Eritrea and, you know, overseas, to be able to encourage people, if you can do sports, you can do anything, because it teaches you about commitment, responsibility, time management, and goal setting. And if you can do those, you know, it's attainable. And if you can do attainable in sports, you can definitely do attainable in academics. So go, they do go hand in hand, because, you know, it's just all about work hard. Nothing's going to be handed to you, but you have to follow the protocols of step by step of key to success. What makes you click in athletics? What makes you click in academics? And if you can do both at a young age, will help you excel in life.
Yeah, I really don't have anything to add. I mean, they both, you know, touched on it. But yeah, just having that mindset of, you know, greatness. You know, I always tell, you know, young adults when I speak to them, is that whatever motivates you to be successful on the field, you know, you can't be great on the field without being great in the classroom first. You know, people sit, you know, regardless of what your goals are on the field or, you know, skating or runnings or in athletics in general, those can't be done unless, you know, you're the best that you can be in the classroom. And that's, you know, what I strive to, is having that foundation.
Excellent. And for those listening about getting more women and girls in sports, let's hope it also becomes a point of pride, if for no other reason. You've mentioned all the right reasons,
yeah.
The reasons this should be happening. But if it's not, look at what your country gains when you do give women a chance and they become superstars and they lead your nation to victory when the entire world is watching. And we've seen that over time from so many nations, Germany, Sweden, China. When women and girls get a chance, they perform, and they perform beautifully. And if that alone is the reason for personal pride, let's hope that some of these countries that are lagging get with the plan and get with it very quickly. Sorry, a little end of political speech there.
Yeah.
But,
well, yeah.
But come on, it is 2013, right?
Yeah.
Anyway, we do have embassies and consulates around the world tuning in, and I know none of you is camera shy. What message? So you're speaking now specifically, well, I guess not to make it a big deal, but to the world, okay? What message would you like to share with our young audiences overseas? So you're speaking right to kids. What do you want to tell them? Matt, why don't you start first?
Well, the Diaspora Global Forum is huge, and we need more things like this to be able to have the dialogue open. And with the new technology, whether it is internet or email, texting, and YouTube, so many things can be made. And have a dream. If you have that dream, you will achieve it. And surround yourself with good people. Do the necessary work. It's not going to be easy, but there's always a struggle. Without Frederick Douglass said, without struggle, there's no progress. Mm. And it's going to test you, but it's going to test you who you are or what your goal is. And if you can make small things at a time, and you will achieve those. Just small goals. You know, you can reach big goals, but you need goals that are weekly, monthly, or yearly versus, oh, I didn't get that, and I'm a failure. But you do make mistakes. We're humans, but don't make the same mistakes again.
Excellent. Michelle?
I would have to agree with Meb about having big dreams. I guess when you have big dreams, it's important to know what you're capable of doing and being organized. And you mentioned time management and making sure that you set goals. Can write them down, but to know that what it takes, do you have the skills? You have to ask yourself, do I have the skills that it takes to get there? And if not, you have to go to the drawing board, you have to work hard, you have to be determined, you have to have courage, and sometimes you have to take that leap of faith. It's not going to be smooth sailing. It's not going to be handed to you. It's going to take a lot of hard work. And that's the thing that I would tell young people is, and it's not to give up easily. Just say, you know what? Oh, I say I did it okay. That's good enough. That to me is already giving up. So pushing threshold, keep pushing. I think in society you see a lot of young people looking up to people in either in the magazines, and they don't realize, like you say, Justin Bieber or Beyonce. They think, oh, I just want to be them. And they have these huge dreams, but they don't realize that it takes a long time to get to that position. And it's hard because you don't see Justin Bieber working hard. He travels constantly. He trains. He works on his voice. Beyonce trains, dances, this. But people don't see the hard work behind it. So I would encourage kids to dream big, but know that it's going to take a lot of hard work.
Yeah, I would definitely say don't let your circumstances define who you are. Don't let your current circumstances define who you are, what your dreams are, your environment, whatever it may be. It may not be ideal or may not be where you want to see yourself, but that's just the beginning. That's where you started. You know, they've all touched on it. You know, even with the example from Beyonce, she didn't start a superstar. You know, she started from the ground and worked to that level, as all three of us have. We all started somewhere. So embrace where you start. Embrace where you are now, but use that as, you know, your memory of where you want to get to. So you can look back and say, this is how hard I worked to get there. Set obtainable goals for yourself. And when you accomplish them, you know, of course, celebrate them, but celebrate them shortly and go on to the next one. Don't dwell on your past. Yeah. Don't dwell on your past success, because that will quickly lead to failure. I always say, you know, failure to prepare is preparing to fail. So always be prepared and always be ready for the next obstacle in front of you. Excuse me.
Excellent. Thank you. And in keeping with this kind of very specific questioning, Sarah Lopez from the Peace Corps has a good question, I believe, again, to tell folks who are watching, listening, will look online. Can you share what role diet and nutrition play in your success? And do you have a specific food from your culture that enhances your performance? And by enhancing the performance, we don't mean illegally enhancing the performance. We're talking about the legal stuff and the good nutrition and food. So a very specific question, Matt.
Well, nutrition plays huge in my success of marathoning. When I was a miler or 10K short distance, you can eat a lot and you only have to go short distance. But when you are going 26.2 miles, you are what you put in your system. And for me, I always have pasta, meatball that my mom always made, Italian style, I guess, more so than anything, and the night before my races. But the culture, the thing that I eat is called hambasha. You might have heard it through Runner's World, but it's homemade bread, and a lot of Eritreans that are in San Diego think my mom is the best hambasha maker there is, and she is, and it does show in my performances. So whenever I'm doing a race within the country, she always comes, she always, like James, his mom, my mom has come many of my marathons and other races, and she always has a hambasha with her for me, and I'll have it instead of opening going to a restaurant, I'll just have it next to my bed. And we get nervous as an athlete sometimes, and you get up, it's like, oh, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, let me have my mom's bread and have that. That's my advantage to keep me going strong.
I guess since I was appointed by the president on the President's Council on Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition, I sort of have a responsibility to eat well and to stay active, especially when you have the First Lady Michelle Obama doing push-ups with you on our Let's Move initiative. But in a more serious note, it's so vital, it's so important that kids put good fuel into their body, because it shows in scores, it shows that being active plays a big part in their grades. Personally, I wish that the Chinese food that Golden Pheasant had, like sweet and sour pork, was, I guess, led to being a world champion, but unfortunately I can't say that. But I do enjoy Chinese food and enjoy it occasionally.
Yeah, I'd agree. You know, as a football player, you know, you're taught for your body to kind of work as a machine. So, you know, the proper fuel you put into it is the results you'll get out of it. You never want to be, you know, sluggish and weighed down. So I tend to, you know, kind of be on a strict diet in terms of eating, you know, meat, you know, vegetables, you know, carbs on the day of, you know, of a game, you know, pasta, meatballs, all that good stuff. But in terms of my culture, I actually eat after the game, where my mom will make, you know, jollof rice and plantain and all that good stuff. But, you know, can't really eat that before the game. Yeah.
Another question, and we have about 7-8 minutes yet to go. I know we won't get to all of the questions, and I know there's so much we could ask these wonderful people, but trying to get in maybe two more here. So this one, leading up to the World Cup and the Olympics in Rio. Of course, Rio de Janeiro is going to be hosting both the World Cup and then the Olympic Games, unprecedented in terms of the world spotlight in sports on one country, one city, within a 2-year time period. So leading up to the World Cup and the Olympics in Rio, there's a lot of talk about how sports events can shed light on issues of poverty and urban growth. How can diaspora communities help sustain that focus and attention? And maybe in your answer, talk a little bit about what your foundations, your charity work, your work, Michelle, within the State Department, if there's a specific you can point to about, again, how your work can help sustain the focus and attention on issues of poverty and urban growth.
Well, I've been very fortunate to be the spokesperson for running arena, but I think it's having such thing like this diaspora here, and as an athlete, we can be utilized as a, publication or notification to others, and what a great opportunity to have those two championships there, and maybe, the State Department or something can do something incoherent with the Olympics there, and you're going to have the top performers in the world there and give them awareness so they can go and talk about it, whether it's online, whether it's their newspaper and things like that. So I think it would be huge opportunity to be able to spread the word of what is poverty and other issues that are core to our heart.
You looked at me when you said State Department. I was recently in Rio on a delegation with the State Department and met with people in the Rio Organizing Olympic Committee who are, in preparation for the Olympic Games and also the World Cup FIFA. And one of the things that kept on coming up was legacy, and you mentioned urban growth and poverty, and sports is really a way to shed light on certain issues, and you hit it right on the head. And I think one of the things that they're very aware of is what do you do to use the platform of sports to highlight issues. It could be development, it could be education, focus on, I know, English component of it. It could be a variety of health issues, social inclusion. I'm on the board of Special Olympics, and having the idea of being able to give access and opportunities for people with intellectual disabilities or with disabilities, or give opportunities for young people to be involved in sports, to get active. It's not only in the United States where you have epidemic of obesity, childhood obesity. It's a problem in other countries as well. So there are many things and many layers, but I think if Brazil can take the opportunity where you have the platform, you have the visibility of hundreds of countries coming to your country, and the excitement as well. The kids are so excited that the games and that the World Cup is coming to Rio, that you take that energy and mobilize it.
Yeah, I just came to mind is, something that we do in terms as NFL players is we have this thing called NFL Play 60. And it'll take place whether it's at the Super Bowl or, the NFL draft or any, large really event space where players will go and participate with local schools, local kids, and help with the initiative of them staying active and seeing the importance of, being outside 60 minutes a day, eating right, all those things, and kind of using that same similar platform as a broader aspect with it being, in Rio and having, the World Cup and the Olympics and be able to use these athletes, why they're there and other athletes alike from other sports to be able to, go to, poverty-stricken places, and be able to speak to these people, be able to do food drives, be able to do, similar, obesity in terms of attacking obesity and saying, hey, You have to stay active 60 minutes a day. Doing all these different things are ways, you know, that they can help, and that'll leave a long-lasting imprint on those kids' lives. Because it's one thing if it comes from, you know, any, you know, politician or whoever it may be, but it's another thing if it comes from an athlete or something that these children can relate to and say, wow, okay, that person impacted my life, and this is what they said I should do to stay active, or this is what I can do in terms of, you know, hunger. Then that's how you attack the situation and make it last for, you know, a lifetime.
Right. Thank you. We have just a couple minutes left. There's a few questions that I wish we could have gone to. I apologize to those who asked them. They're excellent. And it's just a matter of timing now. With just a couple minutes, I thought I would ask each of you to, I guess, in essence, give your closing remarks or closing thoughts, maybe in just a minute or so, and maybe with an eye towards what your hope is for the future. Maybe for the work you may be able to do someday personally, where you might be able to help, or what your world, this world, will look like 10, 15, 20 years from now. I offer those thoughts to give you a bit of a springboard for a minute or so of your final thoughts. Meb?
Well, it's been a great journey for me to start from the humble beginning of Eritrea and to represent the United States to the Olympic Games 3 times and many world championships. And when I won the New York City Marathon in 2009, I got this opportunity to start the Meb Foundation. And with Michelle, we were talking about earlier, sometimes as an athlete, you have to be a little bit selfish just because you have so much demand on yourself, but you also want to give back. So with the Meb Foundation, maintain excellent balance through health, education, and fitness down the road, and kind of laying the foundation a little bit to give back to youngsters to, you know, get involved, just like the 60-minute, NFL 60-minute. We want young kids to go out and play a little bit and eat a healthy lifestyle and beat obesity, and it's a little initiative that will set goals so they could become successful down the road. Because if we invest in the community or in young kids, that's where our future lays. So that's what I hope to do with the foundation. And it's been a thrill of a lifetime, but it's time to give back. And as JFK said, ask not what you could do for your country, but what your country could do for you, but what you can do for your country. So it's time. Been very fortunate enough to have that platform, and hopefully I can give a little bit back, even though it's just a small seed of hope, to others to maximize their potential. Thank you very much for having me. It's been an honor.
Since I work at the State Department, it's hard to say the goals 15, 10 years, so I'll keep it personal. Mentioned that selfish is the word that you used. And I have to say, when in skating, I felt like I was selfish in a way, because you have your coach, you have your parents, you have your trainer, you have the people making your dresses, you have people sharpening your skates. Everything was so focused on me that when I walked out of the ice rink 6 years ago from the competitive world, I said it's time to do something for others. And I think it's one of those things that athletes love to give back. Athletes who feel blessed that they had that opportunity to excel in sports and to inspire others, and using that and using that focus and say, you know what, I want to give back and be involved in many organizations, nonprofits like the Special Olympics, like the President's Council on Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition, like representing the State Department when I travel as a public diplomacy envoy, or when I work here as a senior advisor for public diplomacy and public affairs. It's like finding ways that you can make a difference in the world and making a big impact.
You know, first, it's, you know, an honor to be here on this panel. You know, you think of, you know, as I discussed earlier, and you know, the story of, you know, my parents. You know, Hope Africa, you know, my organization, it's an acronym for Helping Our People Excel. And, you know, we provide, you know, those scholarships for students of African descent to be able to attain, you know, their goal, you know, whatever they hoped for. And, you know, I kind of think of, okay, well, what if Hope Africa was in place when my parents were trying to come from the United States to achieve education? how much easier that burden would be on them. And how, all of us in this room, how many people that have helped us even be able to be where we are. Without those people's support and help, I know I wouldn't be here. You know, the difference between me and a child in Nigeria is opportunity. That's it. I mean, how fair is that? So when you sit here and say 15 years down the road, you know, that saying pay it forward, that's what it's all about. Helping other people so they can excel and then therefore help other people. You know, without that, we would have nothing. We would have nothing. So, you know, really perpetuating that cycle of education and perpetuating the awareness and the importance of lending a hand to another individual.
And with that, just a very simple thank you, James, Michelle, Meb. Remarkable stories, remarkable people. We are so lucky to have had your expertise, your insight over the last hour or so, and we thank you very much. Thank you.